Agette Audio presents Whisky Galore, written by Sir Compton Mackenzie and read by David Rintoul. Chapter 1. The Sergeant Major's Return. From the bridge of the Island Queen, which three times a week made the voyage between Obeig and the outer islands of the Hebrides, Captain Donald McKechnie gazed across a smooth expanse of grey sea to which the rugged outline of Great Todday stood out dark against a mass of deepening cloud in which a dull red gash showed that the sun was setting behind it. Captain McKechnie muttered an order in Gaelic to the steersman, and the mailboat changed her course to round the southwest point of the island that was her next port of call. Presently, the low green land and white beaches of Little Todday appeared west of the larger island, and the mailboat made a sweep to enter the Coolish, the strait of water 2 miles wide, which separated the two Toddies from each other. It was a Saturday afternoon, toward the end of February, in the year 1943, and this was the first time for a week that the mailboat had been able to call at Snorvig, the little harbour in Great Todday, which served the two islands.
"And there's some dirty weather coming,"
Captain McKechnie piped in that high-pitched voice of his, with a baleful glance from his bright eyes at the heavy sky lowering over the Atlantic Ocean beyond Little Todday. At this moment, the trim, soldierly figure of Sergeant Major Alfred Ernest Odd appeared in the doorway of the bridge house.
"Room in here for a little one?"
he asked with a grin of welcome.
"Well, well,"
the skipper exclaimed in astonishment.
"If it isn't Sergeant Odd! Man, where have you been all these months? And where have you been since we left Obeig this morning?
I was having a jolly good lie-down. What a journey!
Stood up in the corridor all the way from Devonshire the day before yesterday. Stood up in the corridor all the way from Euston up to Glasgow the night before last. Stood up in the corridor for the first half of the journey to Fort Augustus, where I had to see Colonel Lindsay Wolseley. He very kindly got me to Obeig in time for the boat, and which meant leaving Tummy at 3 o'clock this morning in the Colonel's car. And as soon as ever I got on board the dear old Island Queen, I got the steward to find me a bunk, and I slept right through the day."
"You've had a long journey, right enough, Sergeant. Devonshire, that's a place I never was in. It's a great place for cream, I believe."
"It may have been a great place for cream before this war, but we didn't see much cream where I've been since I got back from Africa," said the Sergeant Major. "Now, give me good old Scotland before Devonshire any day of the week. Except, perhaps, Sunday," he added quickly.
"Ach, but the Sabbath's not what it was," Captain McKechnie insisted firmly. "When I was a boy, man, it was a day. My word, what a day, too, what a day. I remember my mother once sat down on the cat, because, you'll understand, the blinds were pulled down in our house every Sabbath, and she didn't just see where she was sitting. The cat let out a great skiav, and I let out a huge laugh, and did my father take the skin off me next day. Man, I was sitting down on broken glass for a week afterwards. My father was Kilwilly's head stalker."
"What, Captain Hugh Cameron of Kilwilly?"
"Not the present laird, his father. A fine figure of a man, with a monster of a beard breaking below his nose like a wave on the Skerryvore. Well, 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 it's nice to see you again, Sergeant. You've been away from us a long while now."
"Nearly 18 months, said the Sergeant Major in disgusted tones. "Well, that's the way with the army. As soon as anybody's got a job that suits him, and he suits it, shift him. I was getting along to rights as PSI with Colonel Lindsay Wolseley's..."
"What's a PSI at all?" the skipper interjected. "Man, the alphabet's gone mad like the rest of the world since this war."
"Permanent Sergeant Instructor with Colonel Lindsay Wolseley's Home Guard Battalion. Yes, I've been away 18 months too long. However, the Colonel's got me back at last, and he very kindly gave me the weekend to come over and have a look at my young lady and little Toddy. I was reckoning to get married last autumn year, and then, biff, transferred to a special job in Devonshire, and that tore it. The old man kicked up at the idea of her going so far away, and Peggy thought she couldn't leave her dad, and so that was that for the moment."
"It was pretty annoying for you, I believe."
"Annoying? It was enough to drive a man off his rocker. But that wasn't the worst of it. Last April, instead of getting married as I hoped, biff, again, and it's West Africa, with not enough embarkation leave to risk coming up to the islands.
Then I got back in January, only to find myself down in Devonshire again. Did I create? Well, to cut a long, rotten story short, I'm back at last, and I'm going to get married as soon as ever it can be managed.
You waited a fair time, Sergeant, before you thought about getting married at all, Captain McKechnie pointed out with a shrewd smile. Very wise, too.
Very wise once upon a time, the Sergeant Major agreed. But I was 45 last month, and I can't afford to wait much longer. Here, I mustn't talk to the man at the wheel.
He had noticed that the skipper's eyes were turning away from the topic of marriage towards the Snorrig Pier, thronged as usual with the inhabitants of the two toddies, though it was already on the edge of dusk.
Joseph McCroom will probably come over himself for the mail, as the weather's so calm.
It's calm enough now, but there's plenty turty weather away out there in the west. It'll blow as hard as ever by morning.
So long for the present, Captain. I dare say I'll be seeing you up at the hotel before we cross over to Kiltod.
I don't believe I'll be going up to the hotel this evening at all,
the skipper replied, his usually bright eyes clouded and curiously remote.
But Joseph will expect to have a crack with you, especially as you've had to miss two runs this week.
It's a pity, right enough, but I want to be getting along to the Nobost. Well, I'm glad to see you back, Sergeant, in what used to be the land of the free before this bloody war.
Sergeant Major Odd left the bridge and went down to the promenade deck, where he walked up and down the port side, looking across to the diminutive harbour of Kiltod and the small cluster of houses beyond, in one of which the girl he had hoped to marry so many months ago was waiting for him.
Oh, well, he was back again now. Not like some of those poor chaps in Africa and Burma and India and whatnot, who hadn't managed to get married all those months ago and didn't know when they would now.
Good evening, Sergeant Major.
He swung round to see the stocky form of the Snorrig bank agent.
Hello, Mr. Thompson. You're looking well. I'm glad to see you, he declared, shaking Andrew Thompson's hand so fervidly that the bank agent's dark complexion grew darker with embarrassment.
He was a man to whom words came with difficulty, and he had been walking behind Sergeant Major Odd twice up and down the length of the deck before he had managed to summon up the necessary resolution to break into speech with a greeting.
"You've been away quite a long while, Sergeant Major," said the bank agent,
but the Sergeant Major knew Andrew Thompson's manner and did not suppose that the scowl which accompanied this observation was meant to convey that it was a pity he had ever come back.
"Yes, but I'm glad to say Colonel Wolseley has got me back again at last."
"Mm-hmm. Yes, that's so.
And how's G Company getting on? I suppose you're all as smart as guardsmen by now."
The bank agent made a determined effort to smile at this pleasantry, and in consequence his scowl became absolutely ferocious.
"Not quite yet," he gulped. "As a matter of fact, Captain Waggett has been having a lot of difficulty lately in getting the men together for drill. There were only two at the last parade. That is, there were only Captain Waggett and myself."
The sergeant major clicked his tongue.
"Still, as long as they keep up their shooting," he began. "They're not," said the bank agent, who was also G Company's sergeant major. "The turnout for shooting practice has been very poor all this month. I expect they'll be more keen as the spring comes along." "It's not the weather," Andrew Thompson observed gloomily. "There's another reason."
And then, to prevent his companions asking what that was, he added hastily,
"I took Mrs. Thompson over to Edinburgh on Friday. She's to stay with Mrs. Pringle. That's her mother."
Speech evaporated in a dusky blush.
"And you thought you'd have a little run around on your own, eh? Oh, well, I shall be married myself this spring, if all goes according, so I mustn't talk. I intended to return on Tuesday, Sergeant Major," Andrew Thompson assured him gravely. "But the weather held the mail boat up on Tuesday, and again on Thursday." "A good thing I didn't arrange to come over earlier in the week," said the Sergeant Major. "I'd have gone bats hanging around in Obeg. Hello, we're just getting in. I'll see you up at the hotel before I cross over to Kiltod."
"I'll have to attend to the correspondence, Sergeant Major.
There'll be 3 days' mail, and the head office will be wondering what's happened. I'm afraid you'll find it kind of dull up at the hotel just now.
Well, I won't find it dull. I'm looking forward to seeing a lot of old friends and having a jolly good Jock and Doris, as you call it, to celebrate getting back to the two tightest little islands in the world.
The bank agent smiled sardonically.
They're not very tight just now, Sergeant Major, he said, and went off quickly to find his bag.
Sergeant Major Odd puzzled for a moment over this remark, and then, with a sudden thought that perhaps his beloved Peggy might have come over from Little Todday to welcome him on the pier, he hurried off round to starboard. The pier was crowded with familiar figures, among them Peggy's father in his knitted red cap, but Peggy herself was not there.
"You're a proper mug, Fred," he murmured to himself. "As if the poor girl would want to see you for the first time after nearly 18 months, with everybody staring at her."
A minute or two later, he was hurrying down the gangplank to greet his future father-in-law. The movements of the postmaster and leading merchant of Kiltodd seemed less quick than he remembered them, and his grey moustache, usually so trim, was slightly ragged. If Sergeant Major Odd had not been so acutely conscious of the 20 years' difference between his own age and that of his prospective wife, he would have said that Joseph McCroon had grown appreciably older during these last 18 months. There was, too, in the way he shook hands with him, a kind of absent-mindedness, as if he was hardly aware of the Sergeant Major's presence. And as he wished him "Fortje don duich," welcome to the country, he was not looking at the returned wanderer, but at Roderick McCrory, the owner of the hotel, who was working his great bulk up the gangplank in search of the purser.
"How's Roderick?"
the Sergeant Major asked.
"Ah, he's not well at all, Sergeant. He's had a terrible time, poor soul."
"Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. And how's everything on Little Todday?" "Terrible. Just as bad as here. Terrible."
"Nothing wrong with Peggy."
"What would be wrong with Peggy or Kate Anne?"
their father demanded contemptuously.
"Smoking away, the pair of them, like two peats. It's a pity the government doesn't run out of cigarettes."
Joseph took a battered clay pipe out of his pocket, lit it with a noise like a rotary pump, drew two deep, gurgling puffs at the closely packed twist, removed the pipe from his mouth, spat gloomily between his legs, and replaced the pipe in his pocket. Several of Sergeant Major Odd's old acquaintances had been greeting him, and one of them, a man with a nose and a chin like a lobster's claw, said something to Joseph in Gaelic.
"I don't know, Elchie, but there's nothing to be seen of Captain McKechnie, and if they'd brought it, he'd have come ashore by now."
I believe he would,"
agreed Archie McCrory, generally known as the Biffer, a fisherman of prowess, about 50 years old.
"Aye, he'd have been ashore by now, right enough, if it had been on board."
"Look at Roderick now,"
Joseph exclaimed.
"You can see it isn't there by the way the man's shoulders have died on him. Ah, Dunya Bock, it's me that's sorry for the poor soul. Well, Sergeant, we'll be getting down to the Morning Star,"
he said, thrusting his hands into the pockets of his greatcoat.
"You'd better come up to the hotel and have a dram with me first while you're waiting for the mails to be sorted,"
the Sergeant Major suggested. His two companions looked at him quickly to see if he was laughing at them. Then, perceiving that the invitation had been given in earnest, their manners forbade him to tell him how futile it was, lest he should suppose they had suspected him of a deliberate meanness in giving it. Joseph McCroon sighed deeply.
"What is the use of waiting for the mail? Just a lot of letters for nothing," he declared. "We'll be getting them Monday morning."
Sergeant Major Odd was only too happy not to wait for the sorting of the mail. He had expected to be kept at least another hour or more away from the sight of his Peggy. As Joseph McCroon and he moved across the pier to the steps of the foot of which the Morning Star was moored, Roderick McCrory came down the gangplank.
"Any news, Roderick?"
the postmaster of Little Todday asked.
"Not a single bottle. Ah, Crowhir, this is a terrible war, Joseph, right enough. Do you remember that Sunday night, the day the war started?
Nobody in the islands could mind such a storm of rain. Water! I never saw so much water come down Ben Stickler. My best cow was drowned like a kitten that night. It was a sign, Joseph, it was a sign right enough of what was coming to us. Water, just nothing but water. My brother Simon said we would have to pay for it by going to war on the Sabbath. I didn't take any notice at the time, because an elder has to talk like that, you'll understand. But he was right.
But what exactly happened? How does water come into it?
The sergeant major asked.
Because there hasn't been a drop of whiskey in the two islands for 12 days,
Roderick McCrory replied.
And I was handing it out for a month before that, like my own blood, we were that short.
And we'll have Lent on us in a fortnight next Wednesday,
said Joseph McCroon, who, as a Catholic of Little Toddy, was not prepared to allow the Protestants of Great Toddy a monopoly of religious emotion.
Fancy the government running out of whisky just before Lent. What a government! Do you think Winston Churchill knows they've run out of whisky?
Roderick asked.
I don't believe he will, Joseph replied. It's a pity he wouldn't be saying something about it on the wireless,
Roderick observed sagely, for he was a profound admirer of the Prime Minister's oratory.
You never know what these governments will be doing next. Before we know where we are, there'll be no peer either. We're running terribly low.
The passage of time since last he had visited Little Toddy was brought home to the sergeant major by his first sight of Joseph's youngest son, Kenny, who is now a lanky stripling of 16 in charge of his father's motorboat, and always threatening, when he was denied anything he wanted for the engine, to be off to sea. This evening, the Morning Star was on her best behaviour and chugged across the Coolish without stopping once. The water was as smooth as a tarnished silver plate, and there was still a glimmer of twilight when they reached the tiny harbour on the top of the tide.
"Captain Waggett hasn't managed the perfect blackout at the end of a perfect day yet,"
the sergeant major observed with a grin when he saw the light from Joseph McCroon's shop streaming across the road leading up from the harbour.
"Ach, they haven't drawn the curtains. Plenty time,"
said the chief warden of Kiltodd.
"Plenty time,"
he murmured to himself remotely. The sergeant major felt that he was indeed back in the islands when he heard those two words, and that, of course, gave him the keenest pleasure. All the same, in view of what he hoped to settle about his own future during this precious weekend, he was chary of accepting the dictum too easily.
"Time flies, you know,"
he reminded his host. Then, in the lighted door of the post office, he saw, tall and slim as ever, his Peggy, and a moment later, he was holding her hands and looking into her deep blue, slanting eyes. Chapter 2. The Wake. The gathering in the bar of the Snorvig Hotel on that February evening was so exceptionally gloomy an occasion for Great or Little Toddy, and the host, Roderick McCrory, was so unlike his usual expansive self, that it is only fair to give a picture of the islands in happier times. And, by the kind permission of Mr. Hector Hamish Mackay, the well-known topographer of the Hebrides, to quote what he says about the two islands in his book, Fairy Lands Forlorn. "And so, after sailing for the whole of a fine summer's day along the magical coasts of Tir na n'Og, the gallant Osprey reached Snorvig, the picturesque little port of Great Toddy, Toddy Moor, where we dropped anchor and soon afterwards went ashore to enjoy the hospitality of the Snorvig Hotel and the tales of mine host, Roderick McCrory, the uncrowned king of the island. After a lordly spread, of which a magnificent lobster was the pièce de résistance, we sat outside on a terrace of shingle to pore spellbound over a scene of natural beauty which is nowhere surpassed in all the wondrous West.
Down below, we could hear the voices of children playing among the various merchandise lying all over the quay and pier, until Ian Dhu, the pier master, should find time to put it away in the store. The sweet garlic voices that seemed to reach us like the horns of Elfland faintly blowing. Mr. McCrory, with a grave shake of his impressive head, assured us that the Snorvik children were getting out of hand. Only last week, two of them had ridden into the sea. A motor bicycle just arrived from the mainland for the schoolmaster at Bobbinish on the other side of the island. Soon, however, all discussion of modern youth was hushed by the splendour of the sunset beyond little Todday Veg, which was turning the mighty Atlantic into a sheet of molten gold. Kiltodd, the diminutive port of little Todday, lies opposite Snorvik, from which it is separated by a strait of water 2 miles wide. Little Todday is not so very much inferior in superficial area to its sister island, and probably earned its qualifying adjective by the comparative lowness and flatness of the vivid green Macher land framed by long white sandy beaches, which contrasts with the more rugged aspect of Great Todday. Here the soil is peaty and the shores are rock-bound, while three of its hills, of which Ben Stickler, 1,400 feet, is the most conspicuous, rise above 1,000 feet. The contrast in appearance between the two islands is so remarkable that we are not surprised to learn the inhabitants of both have preserved for hundreds of years an equally remarkable independence of one another, and differ considerably not merely in character, but even in religion, Great Todday being Protestant and Little Todday Catholic. Both of the islands were formerly under the protection of Saint Todd, who is said to have sailed there from Donegal on a log, his monkish habit providing the sail, his arm uplifted in benediction, the mast. He built a church at Kiltodd, the foundations of which, beside a holy well, are still discernible close to the port. My grief! Nowadays, even on Little Todday, the old tales of the saint are passing from the memory, and the store of legend has been sadly depleted. In our time, the two islands display no more than a friendly rivalry, but in the old period of clan feuds, the McCrorys of Great Todday were always raiding the cattle of their neighbours, and the McCroons of Little Todday were not less adept at making inroads upon the McCrory sheep. Authorities disagree about the comparative antiquity of the two clans. The McCroons claim to be descended from a seal woman who loved an exiled son of Clan Donald and bore him 7 sons, every one of whom brought himself back a mortal bride from the mainland. The McCrorys, on the other hand, claim to be descended from an exiled MacLean called Rory Ruach, reputed to have stood 7 feet 6 inches without his brogues. This Rory Ruach was a noted pirate who stole at least 1 wife from almost every island in the West. The fact that there is no legend of his having stolen a McCroon wife is held by those who support the claim of the McCrorys to greater antiquity to prove that the McCroons had not yet appeared upon the scene. We shall not venture an opinion on this vexed question. The air is too soft and balmy upon this June evening for genealogical controversy. Let us lean back in our deck chairs and watch the great sun go dipping down into the sea behind Little Todday. Is that St. Brendan's floating isle we see upon the western horizon? Forsooth, on such a night it were easy to conjure up that elusive morsel of geography. And now, behind us, the full moon clears the craggy summit of Ben Stickler and swims south past Ben Pucker to shed a honey-coloured radiance over the calm waters of the Coolish, as the strait between the two Toddies is called. Why, oh why, the lover of Eden's language asks, must the fair Gaelic word Coolish be debased by mapmakers to coolish, so much more suggestive of municipal baths than of these perilous seas. Alas, such sacrilege is all too sadly prevalent throughout Scotland. We turn our gaze once more to rest, spellbound upon the beauty of earth and sea and sky, and to let our imagination carry us back out of the materialistic present into the haunted past. We see again Rory Ruach's dark galley creep out from Snorvig and sweep with measured strokes northward up the Coolish on Rapine Bent. We see again the seal-beaked galley of the Macroons off Trine na Marach, the strand of the dead, and we hear the voices of the rowers lamenting their own dead chief as they bear his body to the burial place of the Macroons on the little neighbouring Isle of Poppy. Alas, for these degenerate days, although Poppy is still a breeding ground for the grey Atlantic seals, the Macroons no longer use it as a burial ground. But hark! What is that melodious moaning we hear in the west? It is the singing of the seals on Poppy and Pilly, the twin small isles that guard the extremities of little Todday, their fantastic shapes standing out dark against the blood-stained western sky. Would that the present scribe possess the musical genius of Mrs. Kennedy Fraser, that he might set down in due notation that melodious moaning. And now, in the entrance of the hotel, we notice our host beckoning to us. With one last lingering look at the unearthly beauty of this Hebridean twilight, we turn to answer the summons. In our host's snuggery, the glasses reflect with opalescent gleams the flicker of a welcome fire of peats, and as we raise the ushkaveya to our lips with a devout slanchevar, slanchevor, we feel that we are indeed privileged visitors to Tir na n-Óg, and rejoicing in our own renewed youth, we give thanks to the beneficent fortune which has brought us once more to the two lovely Toddies, there to dream away a few enchanted days on the edge of the world. Tempora mutantur. This evening, an almost silent group of elderly or old or very old men sat on the wooden benches round the bar and eyed the glasses of beer on the tables in front of them without relish. Beer does not taste like itself unless it is chasing a dram of neat whisky down the gullet, preferably two drams. To add to the prevailing depression, on account of a shortage of paraffin, only two of the six lamps hanging from the ceiling were alight.
"Did ye hear any word of Donald in the post, Erche?"
The biffer was asked by Angus McCormick, a big crofter with an immense grey moustache who had driven in with the lorry from Garry Boo in the extreme north of the island. Donald was the eldest of Archie McCrory's four sons, now serving their country in the mercantile marine.
"Not a word, not a word," he sighed.
"Ach, he'll be a prisoner of war,"
put in Sammy McCodrum, another Garry Boo crofter, a small man with sparse hair and a nose in him even larger and beakier than the biffer's own.
"Ay, maybe he will, and maybe not," said the father gloomily. "His mother's made up her mind the lad's drowned."
"Where was his ship sunk?"
Sammy asked.
"By what we can reckon, it must have been off the Irish coast."
"Look at that now,"
Sammy commented.
"So near and yet so far, as they say."
"That's the worst of it," said the father. "If he'd been torpedoed away out, it might have been long enough before we heard if he was safe. But being so near, we ought to have heard by now if he's a prisoner of war."
Heads all round were shaken dejectedly. There was indeed nothing in the atmosphere of the bar that evening to encourage an easy optimism. It was at that moment that Captain Alec McPhee, the patriarch of Snorvig, now in his 90th year, rose from his seat and, taking his glass to the bar counter, asked his host to fill it up again. "'I'm sorry, Captain McPhee, but unless the pier comes by Monday's port, "'the pier will be where the whisky is, and that's nowhere at all,' said the big hotel keeper. The ancient mariner, who was sailing the seven seas before the Franco-Prussian War, emitted such a tremendous gasp of amazement that his great white beard shivered like a grove of aspens.
"'Here, nephew,' he exhaled. "'What are you telling me, Roderick?'
"'I'm telling you you've had 2 pints of beer already this evening, Captain McPhee, and no man can have more.' The ancient mariner turned on his heels and walked out of the bar without another word. Outside, they heard the shingle of the terrace crunched by his resolute footsteps. There was neither moon nor star to light him on his way home, but an inward blaze of indignation illuminated the road down the hill to his house, which stood back from the main road round the island in a small garden, of which the principal feature was an enormous clamshell from the Great Barrier Reef, mounted on a small cairn. His own snug sitting room was a museum of his long adventurous life. The walls were covered with paintings and faded photographs of the ships in which he had sailed, with assegais and clubs and blowpipes, with bits of china and bits of armour, while over the mantelpiece hung a glass case in which 2 green pigeons from Fernando Po eyed perpetually an emerald bird of paradise from New Guinea. Into this room, the captain strode upon that dark February evening, and struck the Burmese gong with which he was wont to summon his great-grand-niece Flora, a pretty, amiable, flibbertigibbet of a girl, who at this date was looking after him until she could get to Glasgow and become a tram conductress. An hour later, Dr. McLaren came into the bar, where by now the frequenters were all sitting in front of empty glasses. "Did the captain seem all right when he left here?" Dr. McLaren asked sharply. He was told what had happened. "Well, the shock has killed him," the doctor announced. "And I'm not surprised. For the last 15 years, to my knowledge, he drank his 3 drams of whisky and 3 pints of beer every night of his life, and on such a tonic he might have lived to 100. He's had not a drop of whisky for 12 days, and before that only 1 dram a night for nearly a month. And now, tonight, he wasn't able to get his 3rd pint of beer. Well, it's killed him." Dr. McLaren's usually jovial, florid face was lined with bad temper. He was a man who liked his dram, and he was beginning to feel the effects of no whisky on himself. "I've sent Flora along to her mother," he went on. "I suppose some of you will be sitting up with the body tonight." "I will see about the carriage straight enough," one of the men in the bar assured him. "Don't you worry yourself for that, doctor." When the women had laid out the body in the bedroom on the other side of the passage, some 7 or 8 male representatives of Great Toddy gathered in the captain's sitting room to watch the night away and keep the dead man company. Roderick McCrory sat in the captain's own armchair, and his presence was a tribute to the sorrow he felt for that failure of his hospitality which had shocked the old mariner out of this world into the next. In the armchair on the other side of the hearth, where a well-laid fire of peats was glowing, sat the biffer. Round the table were Angus McCormack, Sammy McCodrum, Alec Mackinton, the headmaster of Snorvig School, and 2 or 3 more. They were joined presently by Norman MacLeod, the attractive young schoolmaster of Waterset, a village at the head of Loch Sleaport, near the southwest point of the island.
"I tried to persuade George Campbell to stay with us for a while," he told the company, "but he went back in the lorry to Garibou. He and my sister Catriona fixed things this afternoon, and they'll be married at the beginning of the summer holidays."
"Ah, well, Catriona will make him a good wife," Roderick McCrory declared amid general agreement. "There isn't a better cook in Toddymore." He paused. "Does Mistress Campbell know George is to be marrying himself so soon?"
"George is going to tell his mother tonight," said Norman. "Och, I'm glad for Katrina's sake, for I'll be away in the RAF any time now. I've had my papers."
"Did you have a good dram to drink their health?" Angus McCormack asked.
"Where would I have a dram in this drought of whisky?"
retorted Norman MacLeod, with an indignant toss of his long, wavy hair. Sammy McCodrum shook his head.
"George will never be having the courage to tell Mistress Campbell he's going to be married on her. Never!"
he declared.
"Not unless he'd drunk a tram the size of Loch Sleaport itself, and then I believe it would turn to water inside of his stomach when he saw his mother gazing at him."
Further discussion of the Garibou schoolmaster's chances of escaping from bachelorhood was interrupted by the entrance of Mrs. Facher MacLean, the captain's great-niece and the mother of Flora, with tea, scones and oatcakes to sustain the watchers. She was a plump, bustling woman of about 40, whose husband was away at sea.
Morag Atul, the captain went terrible quick,
Big Roderick sighed.
"Ah, it was better that way," said Mrs. MacLean. "He lived a terrible long time before he went at all, and I'm sure himself would have wanted to go quick. The Baddock was always so quick about everything. Our Flora got as thin as bone the way she would be jumping when he always put his head round the door so quick."
She surveyed the table.
"There's plenty more tea and scones in the kitchen, and you'll just be helping yourselves when I go back home."
"Tup a late, Amorach," said Big Roderick.
"I can fa'."
The others murmured their thanks and good nights, and when Mrs. MacLean had left them to their vigil, they started to pour themselves out cups of tea.
"Eh, well, well," Roderick muttered with a deep sigh. "It's not for us to crumble at what the Lord provides for us."
"I believe the captain would have crumbled if he was sitting up here with us this night," said the Biffer. "Och, I've often seen him drink a cup of tea, right enough, but he would never be looking at it so lovingly before he drank it, the way he would be looking at a dram."
"That's right,"
Angus McCormick agreed. "It was a pleasure to see the way he would be looking at a dram before he put it to his mouth. You'd almost be thinking you're going to drink it yourself."
"Aye," the Biffer agreed in turn. "There was a relish in the man's eyes which made you warm towards another dram yourself. Crewyer, many's the time I've called for one myself, just because the captain had enjoyed his own so much. When do you think you'll be seeing whisky again, Roderick?"
"Oh, would I know, Archie,"
the hotel-keeper replied somberly.
"Wasn't the minister's wife asking me that very question this afternoon?"
"The minister's wife?"
exclaimed Alec MacKinnon, his thin body bending over the table like a tall black note of interrogation. Norman MacLeod threw back his head and laughed loudly.
Isht, Mr. MacLeod,"
the hotel-keeper rebuked.
"Don't be laughing, please. Mistress Morrison was wanting some whisky for the minister's cold.
My brother Simon went up to the manse to see him this evening, and he says the poor soul has no more voice in him than a bit of dead grass in the wind."
"What kind of a stuffed bird is that at all?"
the high-pitched voice of Sammy McCodrum broke in suddenly to ask. He had been staring for some time at the emerald bird of paradise between the two green pigeons over the mantelpiece.
"I never saw a bird with a tail on him like that."
"That's a bird of paradise, Sammy,"
the Snorvig headmaster informed him.
"A bird of paradise?"
Sammy echoed in amazement.
"How is the captain after shooting a bird of paradise and him on earth? You're making a fun and a joke of me, Mr. MacKinnon, and this is no time to be making funs and jokes of people whatever."
No, Mr. MacKinnon's not joking, Sammy,"
Norman MacLeod assured him earnestly. "Captain McPhee shot it in a balloon."
"Don't you believe him, Sammy," said Alec MacKinnon. "The captain brought it back with him from New Guinea, and those two green pigeons came from West Africa."
"Ah, well. Fancy a man who's travelled about all over the world like the captain having to stand before his creator just for the want of a pint of beer."
Sammy McCodrum shook his head in bewilderment of ironic and melancholy reflection.
"It wasn't the want of a pint of beer that killed the captain, Nahoyle,"
said the hotel keeper. Yes, it was a shock right enough when I had to tell him he could not be having his third pint, but if his constitution had not been weakened so powerfully for want of whisky just at the time of year when a man needs it most, himself would be sitting where I'm sitting now in his own armchair. Gunya, we are all miserable worms in the eyes of the Lord. He just stamps on us when he has a mind to. Did anybody bring the book? Maybe Mr. McKinnon would read us the death of Moses in sight of the promised land flowing with milk and honey.
But the poor old captain never had a glimpse of the promised land, Norman MacLeod pointed out. There wasn't a drop of whisky in sight.
Angus, will you see if the captain has his Bible there? Said Roderick, with a reproachful glance at the flippant young schoolmaster. Angus McCormick searched the captain's bookshelf.
The China pilot, the West Africa pilot, the Pacific pilot, he read out. Och, there's nothing but pilots.
Roderick clicked his tongue.
The poor captain. There's only one pilot for the voyage he's making now. Maybe it's beside his bed.
And it's not for us to be taking it from him if it is, the biffer declared firmly. He was a good man, and he was a very patriotic man. I remember fine when we had no weapons for the Home Guard, and we all thought the Germans would be on top of us at any minute, and the captain brought those assegais hanging up there down to the police station. Aye, and he handed his own shotgun over to Constable McRae at the same time.
Sergeant Ott wasn't too pleased at all this evening when he heard we hadn't been keeping our shooting up to the mark, said Angus McCormick.
It would be the panker who was telling him that. He didn't see Mr. Wackett on the pier,
Sammy McCodrum put in.
I'll bet Wackett hasn't run out of his whisky,
Norman MacLeod chuckled.
You oughtn't to say a thing like that, MacLeod, the snarling schoolmaster urged, unless you have positive proof.
Paul Wackett was the retired stockbroker who had bought Snorvig House and rented the shooting of the two islands from the Department of Agriculture. He commanded the Home Guard company recruited from the Toddies, and in the opinion of the islanders, never allowed himself to run out of creature comforts. And indeed, Norman MacLeod was right. When the watchers down in the captain's house were preparing for their long vigil with the support of tea, up at Snorvig House, Paul Wackett was pouring himself out a carefully measured dram, which he handed to his wife.
If you'll add sugar and hot water, old lady, I'll drink it when I'm in bed. I rather think I caught a germ at the manse this afternoon. Mr. Morrison really ought to keep that cold of his to himself.
I know, dear. I think it's so selfish the way people scatter colds all over the place. I do hope you've caught it in time.
You mean not caught it, Dolly, said her husband with that superior smile which sent his sharp nose up in the air.
Yes, of course, dear. How silly of me.
I think if I drink a double ration of hot grog, I may fend it off. That's the beauty of only drinking whisky on rare occasions. One gets the benefit of it when one does drink it.
Mrs. Wackett, who had been hearing this observation reiterated over nearly 25 years of connubiality, tried to look as if she had heard it now for the first time.
You're worried because there are no lemons, said her husband kindly. Don't worry, old lady. A la guerre, comme à la guerre, as the French used to say in the last war. He stressed the word last severely. The French collapse in 1940 was a favourite theme of his for a display of prosy superficiality, and his wife, who knew it, hurried off to boil the kettle.
You go on, dear, and get quickly into bed. I'll bring your whisky up to you.
When a few minutes later she arrived in the bedroom with a steaming glass of heavily sugared whisky, Paul Wackett was lying back in pillowed luxury.
Now sip this, Paul, while I'm getting ready for bed, and then I'll take the glass away. You won't want it left beside you.
When Mrs. Wackett returned in a dressing gown, her husband was leaning back with an expression of profound satisfaction.
I think that ought to defeat my cold, he announced with evident admiration of his own cunning. Mrs. Morrison was complaining this afternoon that she couldn't get any whisky for the minister.
we still have another bottle?" Mrs. Waggett reminded him.
"I know, but if every time people run out of whiskey we are going to be called upon to supply it, we shall be in the same position as them. They must learn not to be improvident. Improvidence is the besetting sin of the islands. If they had all the whiskey in Scotland, do you think they would be able to keep it? No, no, they'd drink it as fast as they could."
"Just as fast as they could," he repeated dreamily. "But poor Mrs. Morrison never expected not to be able to get whiskey from Roderick McCrory when it was wanted for medical reasons," Mrs. Waggett ventured to point out. "The minister never keeps it in the house."
"That's exactly what I mean by improvidence," her husband insisted. "Look at Captain McPhee. McLaren tells me that it was being suddenly cut off from whiskey which killed him. Of course, McLaren always exaggerates, yet no doubt the old man was inconvenienced. Now, you'd think somebody like him, who has had the command of ships, would have taken care not to run out of whiskey if it was so important to his comfort. But no, he was just as improvident as that silly niece of his who was supposed to be looking after him. It's in the blood. And it's even getting hold of a man like Sergeant Major Odd. I'd no idea he was coming over this evening. I must say, I'm rather surprised he didn't come up to Snorvik House before he crossed over to Little Toddy.
Oh, well, Paul, I expect he was anxious to see Peggy McCroon. He's been away a long time."
"Yes, that's why it's so strange he didn't come up here as soon as he got off the boat. I noticed before he left us to go to that job in Devonshire that this West Highland casualness was getting hold of him."
"I wonder if he and Peggy McCroon will be getting married soon," Mrs. Waggett said.
"I'm afraid I'm more anxious to know if he will be able to smarten up my men. I'm getting terribly slack."
"It is disheartening for you, Paul, after all the trouble you've taken with them."
"When duty calls, we don't consider our personal feelings, Dolly. Where's the book I was reading? I hope you haven't taken it downstairs."
"What's it called?"
"Death in the Jam Pot. It's a crime club volume."
"Oh, dear, I believe I did take it downstairs. Silly of me. I thought you'd finished it," said Mrs. Waggett.
Her husband shook his head. "Don't you start going native, old lady."
She removed the empty glass and went off in search of the book. It was quickly found.
"Is it a good story?"
she asked solicitously as she presented it to him.
"Not quite enough action for me, but it's not too bad."
Mrs. Waggett doffed her dressing gown, got into bed, and composed herself for sleep. Her husband read a few pages of Death in the Jam Pot. But the agreeable fumes of the hot grog made him too drowsy to spot even the most obvious clue, and he was not long in following Mrs. Waggett's example. Chapter 3. A Question of Marriage. The Sergeant Major found Joseph McCroon in a mood of pessimism about the prospect of marriage. When the two daughters of the household had retired to bed with a paternal reminder that the barrel of paraffin was almost empty, that they must not be late for early mass, and that the saying of their prayers did not require a lamp, the postmaster took his guest into the little room at the back of the shop and expressed an opinion that there was enough coal on the fire to last as long as they would be wanting to sit up.
"I was hoping we might settle the date when me and Peggy get safely married, Mr. McCroon," the Sergeant Major suggested, after he had seated himself in one of the armchairs on either side of the hearth.
We'll be talking about that when summer's over," Joseph replied, his eyes wandering round the room, his tone vague.
That'll be quite time enough," he added on a firmer note.
"I don't agree with you there, Mr. McCroon. We'll see better then the way the war is going. These Japs are terrible. I believe they're worse than the Germans," said Joseph.
"Oh, they're regular bastards, no mistake about that.
All the same, I don't see what they've got to do with me and Peggy getting married."
"No, no," Joseph murmured ambiguously.
"Will you have a bottle of ginger ale, Sergeant?"
"No, thanks. I don't think I'll have anything." "You won't get anything," Joseph assured him.
"Do you know when I last had a dram?" 12 days ago.
and Lent begins the week after next.
Don't you ever drink whisky in Lent?
Oh, I drink whisky any time of the year. I don't drink so much of it that I must give it up in Lent.
Then what difference will Lent make? The Sergeant Major asked in perplexity.
Man, we always allow ourselves a few extra drams before Lent begins. You're not a Catholic. You don't understand what a solemn sort of a time Lent is. And it's very long.
We have Lent in the Church of England, said the Sergeant Major. Joseph McCroon looked doubtful. At least I'm pretty sure I remember having to give up sugar in Lent when I was a nipper.
Look at that now, Joseph exclaimed in astonishment. Well, 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 I never thought that the English ever denied themselves anything. Isn't that strange now? Aye, aye, you live and learn. That's very true. When do you think this terrible war will be over, Sergeant?
Oh, it may go on for another 3 years with the Jerrys. I dare say you could add another year or more to finish off the Japs.
That's why I'm anxious not to waste any more time in getting married.
You see, if the war does stop sooner than we expect, my job in Fort Augustus will stop too. That'll mean me going to live down in Nottingham to look after my mother's shop, and I want you to have as long as possible to get used to the idea of Peggy living so far away. Fort Augustus is much nearer her old home than what Nottingham will be, and by the time she and me have been living for a couple of years at Fort Augustus, you'll hardly notice it if she goes a bit further off. Colonel Lindsay Wolseley's very kindly offered me a furnished cottage at Tummy for 10 bob a week. It's a gift. He's a fine gentleman.
Ah, he's a fine gentleman, right enough, Joseph agreed. We've never had a disagreeable word at the council meetings, and I believe he'll support us when the question of the new school for Kiltod comes up again at the March meeting.
I'm sure he will, the Sergeant Major declared fervidly.
The present school is not fit for children at all. It is not fit for chickens. How many water closets have you? One of these wise men from the East, as Ben Nevis calls them, was asking me at the last meeting. General Mackenzie of Mam. How many water closets, General? The whole island is a water closet, I said. The General was a bit taken aback when I told him that. Ugh, I believe we'll get our school right enough.
But Joseph's optimism was all too brief. A moment later he was sighing,
"And yet I don't know so much at all. They want all the rates for themselves in Inverness. They're terribly greedy for themselves on the other side of the county. So many Mackenzies there, and the air just gives them an appetite."
"But what about me and Peggy getting married?" Sergeant Major Odd pressed. "Don't you think just before Easter would be a good time?"
"Just before Easter? What are you saying, man?" Joseph exclaimed in horror. "You have some very peculiar thoughts, Sergeant."
"Well, just after Easter. Anyway, before April's out."
"Ach, we'd better talk about it when the summer's over. I don't know at all why you're in such a hurry."
"If you'd been wanting to marry a girl for nearly 2 years, you'd be in a hurry, Mr. McCroon. And I'm getting on, remember?"
"Oh, you're not so old as all that, Sergeant. I'm 63 myself. Two of my daughters are away married long ago. Peggy Moore's away married down in Glasgow, and Peggy Vaughan's away married in Obeg."
"I know that," said the Sergeant Major, trying not to seem impatient.
"And they tell me Peggy Vegg's going with one of the school teachers in Barra, and talking of getting married to him, Neil McNeil. Oh, he's not a bad fellow, with huge great glasses on him. The fire's going black. You'll be wanting away to your bed, Sergeant, I believe. You must be pretty tired. You're sure you won't have a bottle of ginger ale?"
"No, thanks, Mr. McCroon.
Or a bottle of lemonade?"
The Sergeant Major shook his head.
"I don't blame you," said the postmaster sadly. "That's another thing. How can we have a wedding when there's no whisky?"
"There's bound to be plenty of whisky by the end of April," the Sergeant Major argued.
"It's easy to see you've been out of the country," Joseph McCroon told his guest. "There hasn't been plenty whisky for a year and more.
It wasn't so bad on Toddy Veg while the barrel of rum lasted, but it didn't last long at all. There were too many in the secret. We were all hoping for another barrel when the Jamaica Maid went down last winter off Bar Ahead, but if she had any barrels aboard, they did not come ashore here or on Toddy Moor. No, no, nothing but what they call grapefruits. They were just an amusement for the children.
Yes, I expect they enjoyed eating them.
Ugh, they didn't eat them at all. They threw them at one another. Tray Swish was alive with them. We never thought they were fruits at all, till Mr. McIver, the school inspector, came over and told us what they were. But by then, what was left of them was all rotten.
Joseph McCroom rose from his chair, pulled his knitted red cap over his ears, and moved toward the door where he stood listening.
"The wind's getting up again, right enough," he said.
"You'll find a lamp in your room, Sergeant."
"And you'll think over what we were talking about?" the sergeant-major asked.
"I don't think about it at all," his host replied. "What's the use of thinking about whisky when there's not a nip to be thinking about? I mean, about me and Peggy getting married after Easter,"
the sergeant-major pressed.
"It's too late to be talking about a big subject like that tonight.
What about if Peggy's called up?"
"She won't be called up. She's indispensable to the post office."
"What about Kate Anne?"
"She's indispensable to the croft. She's an agricultural worker." "Hark, the way it's blowing. We'll have a dirty night, Sergeant."
"A very dirty night," Sergeant Major Odd agreed gloomily. And as he lay for a long time awake, on a mattress that was hard even by the standards of hardness to which many years of military service had accustomed him, the heart of Sergeant Major Odd was weighed down by a heavier depression than that now playing havoc with the Atlantic. The higher the wind rose, the lower his spirits sank.
"The next time I come to Little Toddy," he vowed to himself, "I'll put a bottle of whiskey in my haversack, whatever it costs. That's one sure thing, whatever it costs. If I'd only have known in time, I'd have brought a bottle with me, even if I'd had to pinch one. Her father would have been another man if I'd been able to produce a dram for him tonight. He'd have taken quite a different view of the matter. That's the worst of these fathers without wives of their own. All they think about is turning their daughters into slaves. Indispensable. Isn't she more indispensable to me than what she is to the post office? Post office? With a post 3 times a week? Why, it's comical."
Then, for a while, the mattress seemed to grow softer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.